Hi everyone, can you hear me? I see Ankit, Shrey, Shiva and Umesh. Hi Ankit, how are you? Okay guys, let's wait for maybe another 2-3 minutes because we are a bit early. So we'll begin at around 7:30, 7:31. So just hang around for maybe another 2-3 minutes and then we'll get started. Hi Shiva. So we have Mohit joining as well. Hi Mohit. Umesh, how are you, sir? Is my voice clear or any disturbance that you guys hear in the voice? Clear. Okay. Thank you, Umesh. Ankit says perfect. Okay, good. So just maybe another 2-3 minutes. I'll mute myself and then we'll get started in another 2-3 minutes. Yeah. Okay guys, welcome everyone. So we have Ankit, Mohit, Shrey, Shiva, Umesh and Vineet and we'll get started here, right? So today we'll be talking about the basics of R and SAS programming and some of the topics that we'll be covering today, we have already spent some time in previous lessons, so it may be a little bit repeat in some portions of the discussion today. Nevertheless, it should be very, very useful. And pay attention because you will have an assignment based on, you know, whatever we are discussing today. And you'll have to do this exercise on an individual basis and come back in terms of your answers on that, right? So hopefully you'll enjoy the session. And what we'll be doing today, instead of taking a 10-minute or 15-minute break, we'll be taking a 5-minute break only. And we'll be wrapping up the session by around 9:45, right? So instead of going till 10 o'clock, so we'll be trying to wrapping up the session by 9:45. But with the caveat that we'll be having a shorter break. Is that fine with everyone? If you can just let me know. Does it sound okay? Okay, Ankit says sure. Umesh, Vineet, okay, perfect, good. So let's move forward because time is of essence here and we'll make sure that we cover all the topics here, and people who are running late, they can join and they can catch up as we are moving on, right? So everybody has R installed and working, I'm assuming. So if some of you don't have it, just let me know very quickly and I will have Shrey coordinate that activity with you, but I'm assuming all of you are good to go. Shiva Kumar says yes, Mohit says yes, everybody has that, Umesh, Ankit is also good to go. Okay, good. So I think everybody is comfortable with R, right? So I'll suggest, I mean, you guys can either try to copy what I'm doing here on my side and you can try to do it on your end, or you can do it later on. The codes are very, very rock solid, so you can execute. So whatever helps you, right? So I will not, you know, suggest either way. But just to ensure that you have gotten the concepts, you'll have to finish that assignment and send it back to me, right? So that is the plan. So R, I mean, we have talked about the basics, you know, that this is an open source software and, you know, very, very powerful in terms of the statistical and data mining activities and being used heavily in the data science industry as we talk about. Hi, Dinesh. Dinesh, we're covering SAS and R today and we'll be just moving forward with the discussion. We are first talking about the R. And you will have an assignment based on this exercise that you're doing. We have shared all the codes and all this material already. Shrey has sent a note earlier, so you'll have all this with you, right? So R, I mean, as we talked about earlier, is, you know, very, very important tool for the data mining and statistics exercise, right? Primarily driven by its capability and then not to undermine the importance of that it's free. And anything that is free will have, you know, very, very high acceptance in the community, right? So it's free, and being free does not mean that it's not powerful. It's in fact very, very powerful, right? And being used heavily by people across the board, right? So that are the key benefits for using the R, and we'll be covering some of the concepts here today, right? So we'll just move forward with that. So at a very basic, you know, what R is basically it's a calculator, right? So it's a, you can say it's a KLC, right? So it's a calculator and you can do some simple calculation as well as some complex calculation. And so for example, if I want to calculate 689 minus 53, you know, I can go and type it in this area, So can anybody tell me what is this area called where my mouse is right now? What is this area called, guys? If you remember the first of the session, first few sessions that we talked about. So what is this window? Console, Ankit says close, Umesh also says console to enter commands. Yeah, so it's basically for those, I mean, who are not very clear, this is what we called as command prompt. So basically you will type your command here and R will be able to execute that. So it's a command prompt, right? This area right here that I'm, you know, writing on. And what it really helps is, I mean, you can type one by one and it will execute all of your commands directly there, right? Yep, thank you, Mish, and thank you, Ankit. So you can go and, you know, grab this, you can put it here, and you can, for example, if I copy this and come and put it here, somehow it's not typing, whatever reasons, okay. 689 minus 53. So if I enter, it will calculate the difference is 636, right? So I mean, if you have a calculator handy, I mean, if you calculate that, that is the answer you're gonna get, right? But you don't have to type there. You can actually have all your codes typed in this area right here. What is this area called, anyone? This area where the arrow is there, the pink arrow. Script area, Ankit says. That is correct answer, Ankit. Thank you for that. So this is called the scripting area, right? And what it does is basically you type your code directly in here. And then what you do is you highlight on the run button whatever code. So for example, if I have to run this code, I will just highlight this code as I have done over here, and I will click on the run button, and that will execute the code just like what you can do in the window, right? So let me go ahead and do that. And if I just highlight this and click on run, you will see it has repeated the results, right? So it's very, very comfortable, very, very handy from that point of view. Ankit says, or press control enter. That's right, Ankit. So you don't have to necessarily always hit run. So if you look at, you know, what is coming here on the screen, the shortcut is control enter. So you can do that, right? Now in this next, so this is practice one, right? So you can do that. You can type any calculation you want to do. In this second practice, what we're doing here is, and when I say P2, that means practice two, right? P3 means practice three. So there's several different practices that we're doing here, and we'll do it one by one. So Siva has a question. He says, RP in the command prompt area, we have one. Is that something related to vector? So yes, Siva, that is telling, you know, this is the first element, right? So if you have, you know, really long list, and we'll be talking about some of these concepts as we move further in this program. But this one is only having one component, and that's why it's highlighting as one, right? So it will be always there by default. And Shrey says control all, control R as well if you want to run that code, right? So that's good. Thank you, Shrey. So let's go ahead and run this, and what we're doing in the second practice here is that you're assigning values to random variables, right? So X is a random variable, and I'm assigning a value of 9. Y is another random variable, and I'm assigning a value of 16 there, right? So what it means is basically you're educating R that, you know, X is equal to 9. And Y is equal to 16. So if I click on it and click on the run button, those values have been assigned, right? Now, just like in any other program, now you can, what you can do is you can do all sort of arithmetic. So, I mean, I'm doing, you know, all sort of arithmetic based on, you know, what I have run here. And you can see, you know, everything is going to be run just like that. So, for example, if X is equal to 9, Y is equal to 16, X plus Y is going to be 25, right? X minus Y is going to be 7, right? Because 9 minus 16 is minus 7. Right, so square root of X is 3, square root of Y is 4. I can do calculation on square root of X plus square root of Y, which is 7. Right, so very, very intuitive that, I mean, you can do all of these calculation as long as you have the random variable defined. Right, so I can, for that matter, even go and assign X to the power Y. So it will do that calculation, right? Or I can do Y to the power X. So all of these things are possible, and you'll see that R quickly computes these values. So let me pause here and see if there is any question from anyone or things are clear so far. Yes? Clear, what does the square bracket indicate? Is that vector again? Yes, the square bracket, Siva, is basically saying this is the first element. And that is what we are denoting there, right? You will see that terminology throughout R, that it will be, you know, using that all over the place, right? Any questions from anyone so far, or is it clear? Okay, good. So let's move on. So now we are looking at practice three. So we can use, you know, concatenate or combine function. The short for that is C. So C is the function, so I can actually assign a vector of value, right? So when we say vector, that means, I mean, there are more than one values assigned to that, or I mean, vector could be of just one value for that matter. So you can see that I'm assigning values of 1, 2, 3, 5, 9, and 10 to Z. So if I select this and run that, you'll see that the value has been assigned. And if I just want to see, you know, how Z looks like, I go and click on it, and it will return back those values to you. So it says Z is a vector, which has a value of 1, 2, 3, 5, 9, and 10, right? Now, can I do the same calculation as we have done on the X and Y? Absolutely, right? So in this case, for example, what we're doing is we are, let me see if I can zoom in. No, I cannot actually in this area. I mean, I have to increase the font, but that's fine. So in this area, what we're doing is we are actually calculating, we are doing arithmetics on a vector, right? And that vector has many values. So if I do Z times 2 plus 150, do you think this will work or I will get an error? What do you guys think? It will work, Ankit says. Okay. How about others? What do you think is going to be, how many elements will be there in this vector? So if you followed this, Vinith also says it should run, everybody says it should run, Ankit says 6. So how many vectors should be there if I run this particular command? Or how many elements should be there? So Ankit says 6, Vinith says 6, okay? So basically what is going to happen is, I mean, if you look at just this line, and let me circle it and so that you are clear. If I look at this line over here, what I'm doing is basically I'm multiplying each element of Z with 2. So first thing is that I'm multiplying each element of Z with 2. Then I'm adding 150 in each element, right? So let's see how it looks like. So this is the math we are doing very quickly. And if you run it, so this is the output that has been generated, right? So what has happened? So it multiplied 1 with 2, which makes it 2. And then it's adding 150, so that makes it 152, right? What happens here? So it's 2 times 2, which is 4, addition of 150, so that becomes 154. Similarly, you can see all the other elements are, you know, sort of like behaving the same way. Is this clear to everyone? Okay, Umesh confirms yes. Anyone who is not clear, feel free to ask so far, anything that I can explain again. It's pretty basic, but I think it's very important that you are aware of these concepts, right? So there's a concept of vector recycling, right? And so Dinesh also confirms, yes, I'm clear. Okay, thank you, Dinesh. There's a concept of vector recycling, and really what it means is, okay, so Mohit says I'm directly running and then it's showing an error. Because Mohit, you have not assigned the value of Z. Have you defined this one first, Mohit? You have to first define what is Z. Yeah, so run that sequence because you haven't told R, you know, what is Z. So you have to first tell R what is Z and then do the calculation on that. So hopefully that should work, Mohit, yeah? Okay, good. So there's a concept of vector recycling, right? So what it really means is that if I'm adding two vectors here, you know, the first one is, you know, where I have four elements, 1, 2, 3, 4. And in the next one, I have two elements. And if I add them together, right, what is going to happen is that it will do the element-wise calculation, right? So what is going to happen is that it will add 0 to 1 and it will add 10 to 2. What is going to happen to 3 and 4? Any guesses? So it's going to add up two vectors, elements by elements. So the first element of first vector will be added to the first element of the second vector. Second element of the first vector will be added to the second element of the second vector. What is going to happen to 3 and 4? Exactly. So Ankit is right. And what is happening is it will recycle these because when it's looking for the third element, there is no third element in vector 2. So it's going to recycle that. So it's again going to add 0 to 3 and 10 to 4. So let's go ahead and see whether that really happens or not. Right? So this is the result that we have gotten. So 1 plus 0 is 1, which makes sense. Right? 2 plus 10 is 12, which is clear because it's adding second element to second element. Now 3 is 3 again. Why? Because 3 has been added to the 0. So 3 has been added to 0 and 4 has been added to 10. So this is how you're getting the vector recycling, right? So this is how you see that, you know, these numbers are looking, you know, I mean, if it is not very, very intuitive, now you know why they are actually behaving the way they are, right? So first is getting added to 0, second to 10, 3 to 0, and fourth to 10. And that is the concept of vector recycling. So if you don't have the vectors of the same length, it's going to repeat the elements of the shorter variable. Is it clear, everyone? Umesh confirms, yeah, okay. How about others? It's very, very important because a lot of times when you're doing some complex math within the R environment, you may see that, you know, you're not getting the expected results. And, you know, that is how you are supposed to be knowing that, I mean, there might be some recycling happening. So Siva says, RP, can we tell R that the sequence what we want? So you can always create a vector, Sivakumar. So if there is a particular sequence or particular way you want to represent the vector, you can create that, right? But I'm just highlighting the sort of like the significance of the recycling and how it can impact some of the results that you may expect, right? Okay, so let's move on with the fifth practice, which is, you know, something that we have covered earlier. Any thoughts on what this will give me? The command that I'm going to highlight now. This one, what it will give me? The working directory, Ankit says. Okay, that's exactly right, Ankit. Thank you. So if I go and run it, it tells me the working directory, right? And because I've already assigned my working directory, so Sivakumar says gets the directory where we want from. Yeah, so this is the basic default working directory that you have set up, right? If you want to change the default working directory, you can go in Tools, Global Options, right? And it will, you know, give you the option where you can actually change your working directory. So over here, guys, I mean, if you want, you can actually tell, you know, where your working directory is going to be for a permanent basis. So whatever you do here, that's permanent, right? It's going to be actually remembered forever, right? And unless you change it. So this way you can change the working directory, or you can do what I do. I mean, you can, each time you are working on a case, because I want to save it in a separate folder, all the examples and the output and input and so on and so forth. So each time I set up my own working directory, right? So set working directory gives you that flexibility that you can define your working directory. So there's a folder called users. There's a folder called rpandey or rpand. Desktop, documents, classes, basic stat, accelerator, and then basic stat. So this is my folder name. So I'm saying go ahead and make this my default working directory, right? So that is already done. Now in practice six, I mean, you can find out, you know, what are all the elements in your working directory, right? So if I go and actually click on, or I mean, type this command ls and open bracket and close bracket, what it does is basically it's going to show you all the elements in your working directory, right? So if I go and click, or basically highlight this first and click on run, it's showing me all these elements, right? So basically the folder that you have defined and the current R environment that you're working on, it's saying that you have these files existing in the current working directory, the working directory that you have set up. Is that clear, everyone? Any questions? And these elements are actually the elements which are loaded in the R environment right now, right? So you'll see that all these elements are there in the working directory. So Ankit has one question on P4. Yeah, Ankit, go ahead. Console directory will be same as working directory. Acha, so Ankit has a different question. What if the second vector is longer than the first one? So then first will be recycled. So whichever one is the shorter one, Ankit, that will be recycled. So it doesn't matter whether you're adding first to second or second to first. Whichever vector is the shorter one, that vector will be recycled to compensate for a longer vector. Okay. Console directory will be same as working directory, Mohit is asking. So yeah, I mean, so Mohit, you know, whatever directory you have in the R, that is what we call as the working directory, right? So you're just telling R that, you know, this is what my directory is. It doesn't change anything in terms of the actual files or the directory that you have on your system. It only impacts, you know, how R is, you know, sort of trained to look for the information and where it's going to look for the information, right? So this is telling, you know, ls open bracket is telling, you know, all the files which are there in the R environment right now, which is over here, right? Mohit is saying, actually, I can set my working directory, but don't know how to change the console directory. So this is how you change, actually, Mohit. I mean, set working directory is how you'll change your directory over here in R environment. Or do you have a different question? Anyway, so we'll wait for Mohit to come back, or actually he has different question. So Mohit, send me the snapshot of the things that you are having problems with, or, you know, what you're trying to do, and I'll you know, help you out, right? Shiva has a question. Can you unmute me? Okay, sure, Mohit. Yeah, Mohit, you are unmuted.
Yeah, hi RP. Actually, in the console, there it is written that C user ARP and desktop.
Right.
So in mine also, there was some, this address was given.
Uh-huh.
But my working directory address was different. So when I was running the code, then it shows the error. So what I does is, I make the working directory address same as console directory because I don't know how to change the console directory address. So I change the working directory address.
Okay.
So that's why my question is, can I change the console directory address instead of the working directory?
So this address, Mohit, is only for my system, right? So what you're doing here is you're telling R where this file is actually located on the hardware, right? So when you are running the code, you are, you know, you are supposed to change this to wherever you are keeping the files, right? So
yes, sure.
None of these things are valid for you. I mean, this is only valid for my system. So that's a very good question.
Yeah, sure.
Yeah.
Yeah, that I have written means I have given my own path where I have kept that file.
Great. Okay. Then it should work.
Yes.
If it is not working, send me the snapshot, Mohit, what error you are getting, and I'll be more than happy to look into it.
Okay, then I'll show you. Okay,
perfect. Thanks. Shiva, you have a question. Shall I unmute you very quickly? Okay. Go ahead, Shiva.
Happy, can you hear me?
Hi, I can hear you, yeah.
Hey, Happy. We were just talking about the recycling of vectors.
Uh-huh.
We were adding values. What happens when we're subtracting values? Does it throw up a negative value at the end?
Same thing. So recycling happens regardless of whether you're doing the addition, subtraction, multiplication, division. If there is a difference in the length of the vectors, it's going to be recycled.
Okay.
Any other questions from anyone? I can unmute so far. Any other questions? Okay. So let's move on. So we talked about, you know, the list will, LS will give us, you know, all the elements in the R environment. Similarly, you can actually look into all the files stored in the physical location. So in the physical location on my desktop, on my system, this is the physical location. I can look into all the files stored there by, you know, looking into the list.files command, and it will tell me, you know, what are the files residing in this particular location. Actually, you don't have to sort of like browse in the Windows environment if you don't want to, and you can actually look into it. So if I click on it and run, you will see that these are the different files. And this actually answers your question, Shiva, I think you were having earlier. So here you can see the numbers are changing 1, 2, 3, 4. So it's basically telling you all the different elements or all the different components which are there in that file, right? So basically, I have multiple files residing in that area. Now it's basically telling me 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, right? So all of those files are listed here, yeah? So it basically gives you, so it may or may not have anything to do with the R environment. What you're doing in this list.files is you're trying to, from R, find out what files are existing there. So for example, let's say you're doing some coding and you thought that you have kept your, let's say I thought that I have kept my file name this one in that location, right? Before I actually hard code it in my algorithm, I just need to confirm that. So I can actually use list.files to see whether that file is physically there or not, right? So that is, you know, one very, very useful command to always remember when you're working with more complex problems, right? Now, if you need to get help on any topic, you can always put a question mark and put the name of the function. So for example, let's say I don't know, you know, how I can get more details on list.files. So I put a question mark and hit enter. You'll see that automatically, you know, R will open up the help button over here, where it will list, you know, the different features and so on and so forth. And, you know, you can actually read more into it. And unlike, you know, some of the help that you get in Microsoft Office or, you know, some other softwares, I found the help which is popped up in R is very, very helpful in most cases. I mean, it's not helpful in all the cases, but in most cases, you can you know, get some meaningful information if you just look into the help file, right? So always make the point that you don't blindly follow anything. So for example, you know, you can say, okay, I've seen read.csv number of times, but I would like to know more details about that, right? So you can put read.csv and hit enter. And you'll see it's basically giving you all the different options which are possible for that file, right? So very, very important, and I'll strongly suggest all of you to sort of like get more comfortable in doing this, right? So hopefully that should be, you know, something that you can really benefit in terms of your own expertise in the R, right? Okay, so let's move on. And then what we'll be doing now is we will talk about the sequencing and some ways you can create a sequence, right? So for example, let's say I want to create a sequence from 1 to 15. So I can say 1 colon 15, and what it will do is basically it will tell me all the numbers between 1 to 15, all the whole numbers. So basically all the integers between 1 to 15, it will be creating, right? So, or if I want to do it in the reverse order, I can say 15 to 0. So you can see again, all the integers between 15 to 0 have been created. Or if I want to start with a particular place, so for example, pi, you know, pi has a certain value. So R knows, you know, what the pi is. So the moment you type pi, it's basically going to create a sequence from, you know, starting at pi, which is 3.14 to 20 with a certain gap, right? So basically one integer gap again. So 3.141593, then one integer added until 20. It's not going to cross 20 because you have said that up until 20. So 19.14 is below 20, but 20.14 is going to be higher than 20. So that's why that variable is not created, right? Clear, guys, on how to create basic sequences? Okay, good. Now I can also create sequence with, you know, a certain starting value. So for example, I'm saying start at 1, end at 20, and the length is going to be 40. So basically it's going to create a sequence which is having 40 characters or 40 different values in it, right? So it figured out that if you want to do from 1 to 20, I'm going to divide that space in 40 equal part. And that means, you know, around 0.488 is the parameter that it's using to divide that in 40 equal parts, and it will be creating those numbers up until 20, right? So, I mean, if you change it to 50, you'll see that those numbers will change as well. The partition will change. So if I change it to 50 and run it, you'll see now that difference, the difference that was 0.48 earlier is now 0.388, right? So R will be able to create those sort of sequences as you desire them, right? Now I can create some, I mean, there are a lot of things possible in sequencing. I'm just giving you some basic tips. So for example, I want to say, I want to create a sequence which is a repetition of number 1, 2, 3. And I want to repeat each of these numbers 25 times, right? So I say REP, which is a short for repetition. Repeat concatenate of 1, 2, 3. 25 times each, right? So what is going to happen here is you can see very clearly 1, 2, 3, one sequence, 1, 2, 3, second sequence, 1, 2, 3, third sequence, and so on and so forth. And this will be repeated 25 times, right? There's another way you can create sequence. So for example, I'm again doing the same thing, but instead of times, I'm saying each 25 times. Now, what is going to happen is, you know, 1 will be repeated 25 times, then 2 will be repeated 25 times, then 3 will be repeated 25 times, right? So it basically gives you a lot of flexibility in terms of, you know, how you can create sequences and so on and so forth if you're working with some dummy data, right? Any questions, any thoughts, any concerns? For sequence, so Dinesh is asking, for sequence 1 to 20, length is equal to 40. What is the logic used to select those numbers? So Dinesh, if you look at the 1 to 20, it will divide the entire space. So basically, if you look at the difference, so the difference is going to be 19. It's going to divide that entire space into 40 equal parts so that, you know, each part is going to be of equal weightage. So you're saying length is equal to 40. That means, you know, between 1 to 20, I have 40 of these values sitting. So it will basically figure out, you know, how many, what is going to be the right partition looking into the 40 length that you have specified. And that will create the right number of gaps. Is that clear, Dinesh? Okay, any other questions from anyone? Are you guys with me? Just let me know yes, no very quickly. If anybody has any comments, I'll just unmute them. Oh, Dinesh went offline actually. Somehow, I mean, I think he's having some challenges with the internet. Vineet says, yes, fine. Umesh confirms he's fine. What does C means in the repetition command? So C is a short for concatenate, Mohit. So we talked about this a little bit earlier. So it's, you know, you can think about it as a combine, right? It's a short for combine, or you can think about it concatenate, right? So it's basically a short for that. And it's adding up multiple values together. That is the concept behind that, right? Okay, no, that was there, Mohit, in the beginning of the lecture. So I guess, I mean, maybe you were a bit delayed in terms of the joining, so maybe that was the reason, but it was there right over here, right? So where we talked about the concatenate or combine, it is there, so you can watch the video or you can just run the code and you will see what really happens, yeah? Thanks. Now let's move into, you know, some of the other cool things. I mean, we all did this earlier when we can read the file in R, and the command that we are using is read.csv, and as I have shown here, I mean, read.csv has a lot of different things, and you know, read.table is the parent of that. And as a basic parameter, what you have to do is basically you have to tell the name of the file. So I'm telling the name of the file is worksheet in statistics intro day 1 and day 2.csv. My question is, where is this file located? Anyone? Where is this file located? Where is this, where is R gonna look for this file? In the working directory, right? Everybody says, okay, confirm. So this is fine. So whatever is the working directory that you have set up in the set working directory, R is going to look for that. Now, if you don't have this file located in that location, what is going to happen? You will get an error that not able to read the file or something of those nature. So for example, let me change this. Instead of this, I'm going to say 123. Right, and let's say I run this file, right? So you see that I'm getting an error, so cannot open the connection in, you know, no such file or directory, right? So it knows that there is nothing like this existing here, right? So you'll get some error, and if you get this error, what is the thing that you should do? You should just confirm list.files in your working directory, and you see, oh, by the way, yeah, there is nothing called 1 and 3, so it's my mistake. Let me go ahead and correct that and make it 1 and 2, and let me try to rerun it and see what happens. R says, yeah, perfect. Now I can find this file and I'm going to be able to read this, yeah. I do this by going to import dataset under history. Hope it is all the same. Yes, Shiva. I mean, that is exactly the same. So you can go to import for those who like more the Windows-based feature, and you can go physically in that folder location and you can select the file. That is exactly the same thing. So even when you do this, you know, if you come back to this area, you will see that it's running the same command, Shiva. So even when you are using the, you know, the Windows interface, it's actually coming down and running the code in the background. And you'll see those codes being generated over here in the command prompt, right? Now let's talk about something that we haven't covered in great detail so far. So subsetting a data frame. So when you read a typical table like this, right? So table which has rows and which has columns, it's called what? It's called a data frame in R, right? So the lingo that R uses is data frame, right? And you will see that, I mean, when I'm running some of the other diagnostics on the data, the lingo that it uses is the data frame. And what it says is, anytime you want to refer to me a data frame, you have to use a square bracket. And before the comma in the square bracket, I'll be looking at the rows. And after the comma in the square bracket, I'll be looking at columns, right? So this is the common terminology that R follows, right? So I will be opening a square bracket, I will be closing a square bracket before the comma, which is right here, this guy right here. Before the comma, I will be mentioning things about the rows, and after the comma, I'll be mentioning things about the column, right? So this is how you normally refer to the data frame in R, right? Now, what we are doing over here is, I am saying So if you again go back to the same discussion, so we are saying, you know, select rows 1 to 10 and select columns 1 to 3. So I'm telling R that go ahead and create a new data, and this new data is going to be called new cars 1, and you create this from the original data, which is cars, but this time only select rows 1 to 10 and only select columns 1 to 3. So let me pause here and see whether the syntax is clear to everyone. So very quickly, yes or no? Hi Nandini, how are you? Nandini, we are talking about the R and SAS, some of the basic commands there. So I think you missed out some of the portion there. So feel free to watch the video, or you know, you can connect with me offline, or you know, send me a note in case if there is anything that is not clear to you. I'll be more than happy to help you out. And Shrey is here as well. Shrey can be, you know, very, very helpful as well in terms of any of these discussions for today. Yeah, no problem Nandini. I know, I mean, everybody is busy and time scheduling and everything. So is the syntax clear, guys? Everyone, just quickly, yes or no? Okay, so most of you have confirmed yes, so I'm gonna assume that everybody is clear, and let's move on. So if I run it, a new data is gonna be created, and this new data will be called new cars 1, and it's gonna have 10 rows and 3 columns. So if I just want to see, you know, how this data looks like, I can type the name and it will go ahead and run it. So not news, but new cars 1. And you can see the entire data has 10 rows and 3 columns, model, MPG and cylinders, right? Any ideas what this is gonna create based on, you know, what we talked about in the concatenate question earlier? Who can answer that question? What this data is going to create? Or what this command is going to create in terms of the data? Right here. So rows 1 to 10, columns 1, columns 8, columns 9. Umesh says, Ankit says 10 rows and column 1, 8 and 9. Everybody agrees with that? Anybody has a confusion or any different view? Mohit agrees. Okay. So thank you, Umesh, and thank you, Ankit. I mean, those are exactly the correct answers. So if I run it, you'll see that it's going to create the 10 rows and the columns 1, which was model, columns 8, which was, if you go back to the original cars data. So you'll see that column 8 and column 9 has been selected. So this is how you can do it, right? Okay, Dinesh also thinks the same way. So thank you. Now, what will this do? The third way of selecting the data. Any guesses? So Umesh says rows 1 to 10, columns origin and columns year. That's exactly right. So instead of telling the number of the column, you can tell R the name of the columns. But keep in mind, whenever you're talking about the names, you have to put them in the double quotes. So you say, okay, select the columns which is named origin and select the column which is named year. So it becomes really intuitive because, I mean, sometimes you don't even want to specify the numbers, but you know what are the names of the variables. So you can tell the names of the variables directly or the names of the columns directly, and it will be able to pick it up, right? So let's go ahead and run this guy also. And then you can just quickly confirm new cars 3. And there you go. So two variables only, top 10 rows, origin and year, right? So is everything clear till practice 11? Now you're going to go to practice 12. But any questions from anyone? Okay, perfect. So now we are using some of the more sophisticated things. I mean, I think Ankit, you were asking me this question on WhatsApp sometime back. So I thought maybe for the benefit of the class, I can highlight this one more time. So for example, let's say you want to select, you know, maximum or a minimum and things like that, that we typically do. and I think it's part of your assignment as well, which you'll be doing later on. And anytime you have a question, feel free to ask Shrey or me on R and on Excel, Tableau, and you know topics that Amit is covering. Feel free to get in touch with him. We'll be more than happy to help you out with any assignment, right? So don't think that you alone have to solve it. We'll be more than happy to help you out in case if you're stuck in some point, right? So for example, here we are saying, okay, tell me all the cars, or tell me the cars which have the maximum miles per gallon, right? And the nomenclature here is, you know, if you haven't attached the data, for example, if you haven't told R that I'm working with this data, anytime you're referring to the names of the columns, you have to use a dollar symbol, and then you have to use the name of the variables, right? So which max is a function in R, and basically it will give you the maximum value for the variable that you have selected. So what you're telling here is that R create a new data, which is called new cars 4. You use the original data, which is called cars, and you only select those rows where the miles per gallon is highest, and show me all the columns. So if there is nothing populated after the comma, that means select all the columns, right? So let's go ahead and run this guy. Right, so this is created. So if I go and pull the new cars 4, so it's basically, you know, showing me the cars with the highest miles per gallon. So there's just one car, which was at the observation number 329, and that car has the miles per gallon of 46.6, believe it or not. So in one gallon, the car goes 46.6 miles, right? And it gives you all the details related to that car, right? So this is one way of doing that. You can also do, which is, you know, sort of like you say, where this is leveraging, where, you know, you select the you're creating a new data, selecting from the original data. You're saying where cars dollar MPG is equal to max cars dollar MPG, and select all the columns, right? So this is the same thing. It's not going to be anything different. So if I run it and then click on it, again, the same thing pops up there, right? So no difference at all. Any ideas? What is this doing? Row number 62. So Shiva says we are selecting the lowest miles per gallon instead of the highest, right? So basically tell me all the cars which have the lowest miles per gallon. So Shiva, Mohit, Dinesh, thank you. It's exactly same as which max, but now instead of finding the cars with the highest miles per gallon, I'm finding the cars with the lowest miles per gallon. So let me go ahead and run it. And if I click on it, so which is the car which has the lowest miles per gallon, and what is the miles per gallon looking into this data? So the lowest miles per gallon is 9, and it's the HI 1200D, and this is an American car, right? So you see clearly that there is a, you know, one car which is giving you the 9, and the basically the lowest miles per gallon is a 9, and the highest miles per gallon is 46.6, right? So similarly on line number 63, I can type the same way and it's going to give me the identical results. So there should be no difference, right? So there are multiple ways of doing things in R. I would say that there are at least a dozen ways of doing the same thing in R. So your logic could be different from my logic, or Ankit's logic could be different from, you know, anybody else's logic, right? So there's nothing wrong with that. So I'm just showing, you know, few ways to do that. It doesn't mean that you have to always use this, because you can do it in a number of different ways, right? Now, how do we create a new variable in the data set? And that is the practice number 13. So suppose I have to create a new variable, which is a derived variable. So let's say I want to create a variable called miles per gallon per cylinder. So for example, what if for whatever reasons I want to know per cylinder in the engine. Hi, is there a question?
Yeah, RP, this is me here, Amit, and yeah. I just wanted to remind everyone very quickly as I was leaving the session that there's a class on Tableau tomorrow, and everyone needs to install Tableau and they will get a global superstore data set from Shrey. So request everyone to install Tableau tonight or tomorrow morning before tomorrow's class. That's all I wanted to share. Thank you.
Sure, Amit. Sure.
Thank you. And sorry for the interruption.
No problem. No problem. Thank you. Everybody got that, right? So you have to install Tableau. People who don't have it, you have to get in connect with Shrey. Shrey is going to send out detailed instructions as well. Yeah. Shrey, do you want to just quickly talk to the team about that? I can unmute you very quickly.
Shrey will send out an email to everyone with installation instructions and, you know, the data set. Mm-hmm. And it's a lot of fun. It's all drag and drop tools, so everyone will really enjoy Tableau tomorrow. That's about it, RP. It's just an announcement.
Okay. Thank you, Amit. Okay. So we'll move on with the R discussion here. So, guys, I was saying, for whatever example, let's say you want to find out, you know, what is the miles per gallon per cylinder. So you can have more cylinders, you can have less cylinder in the car, and you want to normalize for the number of cylinders. So I want to create a new variable, which is MPG per cylinder. And I'm defining, you know, that cylinder, that formula is basically, you know, you have to look at the MPG car miles per gallons for the cars, and you have to divide the by the number of cylinders. And if I do that, it will create a new variable. So if I go to the cars data and go to the extreme right, you see that the new variable has been created, right? And this new variable is nothing but you take the miles per gallon, you divide by the number of cylinders, and you get, so if you do these two, you get this value, right? Which is exactly what I've told. So you can do any sort of arithmetical calculation, any sort of logical, you know, test or anything that you would be able to do in Excel, in R as well, by creating a new variable, right? And how we did the new variable creation is very, very simple. You just tell that in the cars data, I want to have a new variable called this. So you can name this variable whatever you want to call it. Then you have to tell, you know, how this variable is going to be defined. So you said, okay, this is the MPG divided by the number of cylinders, and MPG is residing in the cars data, and cylinders is also residing in the cars data. Is this clear, everyone? Yes, no? Yep, okay. Ankit confirms. How about others? Is this clear how you define new variables? Shiva also confirms. Dinesh, okay. Mohit, good. Okay. Now let's say I want to create a new variable and I want to do some conditional things on that, right? Vinith also confirms. So let's say, so right now if you go to the cars data, this is my last variable, MPG per cylinder, right? So I want to create a new variable called mileage, right? I want to create a new variable called mileage, and I want this variable to have two values, good, not so good, right? So for example, you know, I want to look at the actual numerical miles per gallon, and using that, I want to create a new variable called mileage. If the car gives me more than 30 miles per gallon, I want to call this car as good. If the car gives me less than 30 miles per gallon, I want to call this car as not so good, right? And how do you do that? I'll just quickly give you the syntax of that. So the command that we use in R is if else, right? So just like what you would do in Excel. So if you use the if clause that Amit will be covering for those of you who are not aware in the Excel in I think a few weeks or maybe a couple of weeks. You can do the same thing in R using if else. So you say if else cars MPG is greater than or equal to 30, it will hold this value, right? So this is basically when this condition is true, when the condition is true, the value is this. When the condition is false, the value is going to be this, right? So when the cars miles per gallon is more than or equal to 30, the variable will be holding the value of good. When it is not the case, the variable will be holding the value of not so good. Is that clear, guys? So let's go ahead and run that and let's see what comes out. So I did this, and then if I go and look into the cars data again, you see that I have a new variable called mileage. And it will be looking at the miles per gallon. So for example, you know, all these cars have less than 30, so they are called as not so good. Let's pick a car which is more than 30 or greater than 30. So for example, this car has 30. and it's called good, right? Similarly, this car has 31, it's also called good, right? And you'll see that, I mean, it has done the conditional coding for you all across the board, right? So that is the benefit in terms of using that. So Ankit says, what if we want to include more conditions? So just following the same logic, Ankit, you can have as many conditions as you want, right? So for example, you know, you can say, if this is the case, then hold this, and then you can have another if-else condition here. So it can be nested. So just like, you know, any sort of nesting algorithm that you have in Excel, you will be able to nest if-else statement. So you can have the nested if-else statement. You can have as many conditions as possible. Okay, good. So let's move on. So that is created. Now, summarizing data, what does it do? Head of cars. Top six rows, right? Tails of cars, tail of cars, bottom six rows, right? Structure is basically telling you, you know, the top six, bottom six, the type of the data, you know, how many variables are there, how many observations are there, all of that. What is DIM? DIM is a short for dimension, right? So how many rows, how many columns? Some of this is a repeat, so kindly ignore that. Names basically will tell me the names of the variables of the car. NCOL will tell me how many columns are there. NROWS will tell me how many rows are there. And class will tell me, you know, what is the class of the cars, right? So if I go and highlight all of them and run, you'll see that everything is populated, right? So I have the head of the cars, I have the tail of the cars, basically the top six and the bottom six observation. Structure tells me that this is a data frame, that many observations, that many variables, observation meanings, number of rows, variables meaning the number of columns, and it's giving you the type for each one of them, you know, what exactly they are. Dimensions is also telling you the same thing, right? So if I have to pick any single command which is the most powerful, that is str, which is a short for structure, it's going to tell you every single information about that data, right? So this is, I mean, just to sort of like really understand about your data and what exactly is there. Now in exercise 15 or practice 15, what we'll be doing is we'll be doing descriptive statistics on the data. And first thing that we're doing is attaching the data called cars. So that means, you know, every time I'm referring to the variable, I don't have to say, you know, data dollar variable. I can directly refer to the name of the variable. So let me go ahead and run that. Then I am running whole host of things. So just like what we have done in Excel, so you can do mean, median, mode, variance, standard deviation, range, min, max, and quantile. So I'll run everything till quantile. Quantile syntax I will explain you a bit more. And you can see that all the values are calculated. So the mean miles per gallon is 23, median is 22, mode is numeric, variance is given, standard deviation, range, minimum, and maximum, right? Quantiles is a little bit different. I mean, here you can actually specify, you know, what values you want, and that gives you more flexibility. Dinesh is saying, what does attach car do, does, right? So basically, Dinesh, if I don't attach, I'll have to type like this, right? So I'll have to, so for example, if I want to do a mean, I will have to do like this, right? So mean cars dollar MPG. Because every time I'll have to remind the R, you know, where this MPG variable is there. So I have to add a dollar and I have to add the name of the cars. I add the name of the data set where this variable is located. If I want to avoid, you know, having these things repeated multiple times, which is the cars dollar, name of the data and dollar sign, I can just say attach and just directly talk about the variable name and that will do it. Is this clear, Dinesh? Okay, good. So I was talking about the quantile. So quantile, basically, you know, you have to specify the variable on which you want to build the quantiles. This is, you know, talking about the sequence that we talked about earlier. You say begin with the 0 and then go with 1. So basically 0 means from 0 percentile and 1 means till 100 percentile and in the gap of 5%. So you can see clearly that it has created 0, 5%, 10%, 15%, 20%, so on and so forth till 100%. So basically all the way up from 0% to 100 percentile you will be having with the gap of 5%. right? So if you don't want to do, you know, with the gap of 5%, for example, and if you want to do with the gap of 10%, you can go here and change 0.05 to 0.1, right? And now it will create the quantiles with the gap of 10%, right? So you can see clearly the difference. Is this clear? The quantiles, how to get the quantiles and how to manipulate that, different cuts, very quickly. Ankit says, can you repeat once more? Sure, Ankit. So the logic for the quantile is you have to tell, you know, from which place to start. So I'm saying, you know, start with the zero percentile, and then it's basically which is the point you want to stop, which is the one, which I'm saying is 100%. And then I'm saying, you know, what at what interval you have to create the percentile. So I'm saying create the percentile at 5% interval, which is, you know, the first output here. So 0%, 5%, 10%, 15, 20, and so on and so forth, right? So you can see clearly it's the interval of 5%. Now what I did in the second one is I said, okay, I don't want at the interval of 5%, I want at the interval of 10%. So I said, again, start with the 0%, go to the 100%, and then create with the gap of 10%, which is 0.1. So you can see very clearly that it has created at the gap of 10%. Is this clear, Ankit? Okay, good. So that's what we can do in terms of the quantiles, and you'll be having some hands-on practice on the data that we will be working on, and I'll just briefly explain that case to you. There is a package called FBASIC, so you have to install that package, and for those of you who don't know how to install the package, and if you don't have it, you have to type install.packages, right? So you have to go here and type install.packages, right? And you have to name that package that you want to install. So F.F basics is the package that we need to do. So because I've already installed, I don't need to do that. I will just simply go ahead and load that package, and you can load a package using library. So I'll load the package, and what this package does is basically it gives you a lot of flexibility in terms of creating all these statistics in one go. And the function that we use for that is called F, the basic stats. This is the function name, basic stats. So it's going to generate most of the values that you have seen earlier and some more. And then you say, okay, on what data you're going to run. So you say on cars data, and then you say, you know, select all rows, but only select columns 2 to 5. So it's going to say 2, 3, 4, 5. It's going to generate basic statistics on all this data, right? So basically, rather than you doing it manually one by one, you can do it in one go. So if I click on it and run it, you can see clearly that this is how the output would look like. It has generated, you know, the number of observations, the number of missings, the minimum, the maximum, first quartile, third quartile, mean, median, sum, and so on and so forth for all the four variables, right? So very, very powerful function. So Dinesh says, if I don't have a package installed and if I try to invoke the package, what is the error like? So you'll get that this function name cannot be found. So if I don't have the FBasics installed, when you type the basic stats, Dinesh, it will say the function is not known, because it doesn't even know whether there is a function called this unless you install that package, right? So you'll get an error that I'm not able to recognize that function, right? Now, so you see that there are multiple zeros, right? So I mean, sometimes it's very stupid to, you know, show 5 zeros or 6 zeros when it doesn't really make sense. So I can round it off, and the function that is used for that is called round, right? And if you look at, you know, what we did earlier versus what we're doing now, the only difference here is that I'm saying, you know, digits. So the function is round. Do the exactly the same thing that you have done earlier, but you're saying only show 2 digits, right? Let's go ahead and run it. And you can see clearly this output makes much more sense, right? And now I only have 2 digits rather than, you know, having 15 digits after the zero, right? So this is how you sort of like round up things and make sure that you don't show things which are not meaningful. Yeah? Why the extra column, why the extra comma after the square bracket, Umesh is asking. After the square bracket, this one, Umesh, where my mouse is, this one. I can unmute you, Umesh, if you want to. To the right. This one, right? So basically this is telling you, Umesh, that I mean I am first of all selecting all rows and these columns, and I'm running this rounding on all the things which are there. So you select, you're telling that all the columns which are selected there, you have to run it on that, right? So go step by step. So for example, this parenthesis is for this, so which is the rounding, and you're telling till what digit you have to round. And from there, you'll just work one by one bracket in, and you'll figure out what exactly you're doing. So in this, I'm selecting all the rows and these columns only. And then I am specifying you have to select all the columns from this data after you've done it, and then you actually run it on that. Dinesh says, is it possible to dump the output of a command, for example, to Excel file? Yes, Dinesh, I'm coming to it. So just give me a minute, I'll come to it. And I think I have done it, I have done it in some place, Dinesh. So just give me a minute, you'll be able to see that, right? Okay, let's quickly run to the other one. So correlation, we have done it earlier. So for example, here I'm creating a new data, which is new cars, and I'm only selecting these variables, MPG, cylinders, engine, weight, as we discussed earlier. And let's go ahead and create this new data. This is called new cars. And then I'm running, correlation. So if I want to correlate all the variables to each other, and remember that correlation will be only valid for numerical variables, right? So, and that's what I'm selecting. MPG is a numerical variable, cylinders is a numerical, engine displacement weight, all of them are numerical variables. So I select cor, which is basically short for correlation, the function name, and I go ahead and, run the correlation. So I say, this is the name of the data. Use complete ops is basically, a short for saying that anything missing, do not use them. Only use on cases where everything is populated. And method used for the correlation is Pearson. And if I go ahead and run that, you can see the correlation matrix has been generated right over here, which is giving you the correlation of each of these four variables to each other, right? Obviously, MPG is related to MPG, and you will see the highest correlation, which is absolute correlation, and then you will see, all the other correlations, right? If I don't want to run, all of them together, I want to run only one variable, I can say, correlation of MPG to weight only, and I click on run, and it gives you the exactly the same variable. This is something we have discussed in the first class itself, right? So it's a repeat. So Dinesh is asking what other methods are available. So Dinesh, if you just go and type correlation, for example, right, and you will see that the function is giving you help. So there is a Pearson, there is a Kendall, there is a Spearman, right? The default is Pearson, and that is the most popularly used. But you can do research on Kendall and the Spearman, and if it makes sense, you can go ahead and use them. But I mean, Pearson is the default one, right? Now, a lot of times we need to count things, right? We just need to do simple counting. So there's a package in R which is called PLYR, right? So if you don't have the package, you'll have to do the install package PLYR, and you install the package. It's really helpful in a lot of different things, but what we're using it for now is for the counting, right? And I'll show you how the counting really happens. So once I have installed the package PLYR, I say count cars by origin. So for example, if my manager wanted to know how many American cars are there, how many European cars are there, how many Japanese cars are there, right? So I'm not going to go and manually count these cars. And if my data is in millions, that's even impossible, right? So I will simply say, look into the cars data and tell me the count by origin, right? So basically tell me the distribution by origin, how many cars are there. So if I go and run all of them in one go, it has generated the output. So how many American cars are there, anyone? Two hundred forty-five American cars are there, Ankit says, thank you. European cars 68, Japanese cars 79. So you can do very, very quickly the counts of those things, right? And you'll find it very, very helpful when you're trying to explain and understand your data very quickly. So it's very, very easy. So you can do that. Now, I think Dinesh, you were asking, can I write this data in Excel, right? So I'm doing exactly the same thing over here. So, but anything that you want to write in Excel, just like there is a function called read.csv, we use a function called write.csv, and that will write into the Excel file. So I write.csv, and I do the same thing. And in the end, what I'm doing is I have to tell the name of the file. So the name of the file is countsheet.csv. and it's basically going to store this information, and write.csv tells R that, you know, whatever is the output generated from this function, you go ahead and write this output in the file called this, right? And that's all you are doing in R to sort of write things in R, right? So Sivakumar is saying, RP, I installed the ggplot packages. When I close R and reopen, I lose the package. Do I need to install every time when I open R? No, Sivakumar, shouldn't be the case. You just need to say library ggplot. So you don't have to reinstall it. You just say library ggplot. So that means you load up the package in the R environment, right? You don't have to necessarily install every time. So if I go ahead and click on it, basically it's going to write the file. And this file is going to be written into the output over here. So you see that there's a file created at 8:37, which is the time now. And the file has the same name as I specified in R. And you see, you know, whatever was the output that we saw in R has been replicated in Excel, right? So very, very convenient to sort of like work with this and, you know, have all the things installed, I mean all the, you know, things exported into the Excel environment. So Vinit is saying not able to install package PLYR. Vinit, there might be some dependencies, right? There might be some dependencies that you have to ensure that you install. It will tell you that this package is missing, so you have to install those packages first. In any case, if you need help, Vinit, feel free to ping me or Shrey and we can walk you through later on, right? Okay, so let's move forward very, very quickly because we'll spend some time talking about the SAS as well. Very, very important function in R, which is called aggregate. And basically what it does is, I mean, you can create the mean, max, and min. And I'm asking you guys to calculate the same things for your assignment as well on a different data. So pay attention. So aggregate, you first have to tell, you know, what is the variable you're going to run the aggregate on. So you say MPG. You say, you know, how you want to calculate. So basically you want to calculate the miles per gallon by origin. And what is the metric that you want to calculate? So you're saying, you know, give me the miles per gallon of the cars by the origin and give me the average miles per gallon over here, right? So if I run that, you will see that American cars have on average 20 miles per gallon, European cars have 27, Japanese have 30.45, right? Similarly, I can run the aggregate on max. So what is the max an American car can give me? 39. What is the max European car gives? 44. What is the max Japanese gives, which is 46.6. And if you remember, this was the highest miles per gallon that we got from the overall data, right? Similarly, I can find the min. And min is 9, which is again the same thing that we got earlier. But now you know which car is giving you the minimum. So that's the American car, right? Min was 9. So Dinesh is confirming that. Yeah. So basically you can see grouping by different variables. So basically I just wanted to know, you know, by the origin of the car, what is the min, what is the max, what is the mean, and so on and so forth. And you can do that very quickly here. Right. So now let's go into the plotting, which is the practice 6, and library that we are requiring for that is ggplot and grid extra. So if you don't have these libraries, you'll have to install them. And we did it very quickly. Now this is, you know, ggplot, and this is a little bit advanced topic, but basics of ggplots, I mean, everybody should know. So you first tell the name of the data from which you're going to plot. And then you're saying, you know, what is going to be on my x-axis, what is going to be on y-axis. So origin is going to be your x-axis, MPG is on the y-axis, and you do run that, but nothing is plotted because all you have done is you have assigned the value to a variable called p. Now you have to tell how the p is going to look like. So you say plot p in a box plot fashion, and, you know, the origin will be used as a color for different box plots. So if I go and run this, you see now the box plot has been generated, and this you guys have done earlier. So by origin, it's plotting the miles per gallon, and the color of the boxes is driven by the origin, or, you know, where the car is made, right? So this is, you know, how you can generate the chart on anything, right? So this also we did in the first exercise. It's a repeat, right? This is new concept and that you should try. This is what we're trying to do here is basically we are plotting things in a scatter plot. So again, you assign the value from the ggplot to a variable called p1. you say ggplot cars, and you say x-axis is going to be horsepower and y-axis is going to be weight. So you run that. Again, nothing is plotted because you have assigned the value to a variable called p1. Now you say, what we going to do with p1? So you say p1, you're going to plot them in scatter plot. So geom point, you say the color is going to be the origin, from which origin the cars are, and you are saying, use their colors. And now you're saying, I want to have particular color selected rather than R selecting the colors for me. I want to select green, purple and orange. So if you want, you can select any other color. So let me go ahead and run this. And you see this nice chart generated. So green, purple and orange, as I selected earlier, it's saying, the relation between horsepower and weight is like this. So which is very, very linear. And it's also visibly, identifying which cars are American, which cars are European, which cars are Japs, right? Now, if for whatever reasons you're not, liking the green, so you can go ahead and change it to red. And, I can change this to blue, right, and orange, right? So you can change any color you want to. It will just follow your command and it will plot that, right? So it's very, very nice feature and very, very, visual way of looking into the information in R. And it will tell you, things very, very easily, right? So that's all, guys, in terms of the basic introduction of R. What we'll be doing in the future lecture as we move on, we'll be talking more in details, specific commands, but I think this is more than sufficient to at least get you started in terms of your journey. And as we move forward in the lectures, you'll get more and more knowledge about the different functions and all the nuances there, right? Now, let me talk about the assignment that you have to do. And this is also something Shay has already sent you. So there's a file called credit.csv. What this file has is basically it has the actual credit card performance data of some customers. So there's income of the customer, there's a credit limit. So this is something that the banks will say that you have a credit limit on your card as 3 lakhs. So that means you cannot spend more than 3 lakhs on your card. Your income, your credit limit, your rating meaning what is your bureau score. So we talked about this earlier. Everybody has a bureau score. So in terms of what is your credit worthiness, whether you are, sort of like high risk or low risk. Higher the score, lower the risk for you, right? And then how many cards you have, basically from the bank. Then what is your age? What is your education? And this is a number of years of education. What is your gender? Whether you are a student or no. Whether you are married or not. Whether you are, African American or Asian or Caucasian, which is nothing but the white people. And then what is the balance on your credit card, right? So this is the actual data from the banking industry, from the credit card in particular. So what I'm asking you to do is basically do what we just did in my other data. So first of all, you have to generate the summary of all the variables and describe in your own word what are your key observations. So just based on the descriptive statistics, what do you notice, right? So which variables are doing what, and sort of like all of those things you have to sort of tell me, right? So a very, very high level. Then you have to generate correlation of all the numerical variables, just like what we did earlier. And you have to tell me what are the top 3 most correlated variables to balance, right? So if you go back to the file, there's a variable called balance. You have to tell me which are the variables which are highly correlated to balances, and what are the top 3 variables which are correlated. Then you have to tell the mean of balance by gender, just like what we did by the origin. You have to do the same thing, but you have to tell me what is the mean of balance by gender, whether males have higher balances or females have higher balances, right? Then you have to tell me which ethnicity has the highest income and which one has the lowest income, right? So again, like the min and max that we did there, you have to tell me which ethnicity has the highest income, which ethnicity has the lowest income. You have to generate the plot between limit and income and color the points by ethnicity. So you have to generate, what is the limit by income and where are the African Americans, where are the Caucasians, where are the Asians, right? Is this assignment clear, everybody? Does it make sense? Can you do it? Okay, so Nandini says yes, Ankit says or word file, Umesh says sure. Yeah, it's a Word file, Ankit. So the problem is given in the Word file, but the data is in the CSV, right? So what I will request you guys to do is basically the code that we just went through. You have this code, entire code with you. So first run it and try to understand everything that is happening one by one and make sure that you really understood the concept. Then apply the same concept. So I'm not asking you to do anything different. The only thing different is there is a new data. So rather than you just trying to replicate the same thing on the same data, you have to grab a new data and apply the same things and tell me some business insights on that, right? So that is the value add that you'll be bringing. So you tell me, you know, what is most correlated to balances, whether African Americans are behaving differently than Caucasian or Asian, because this is the real problem solving, right? And this will also get you introduced to some of the concepts in the banking industry and some of the key things related to the credit card, right? Does it make sense? So you have time till next Saturday. So send it to me by Saturday afternoon. That would be fine. If you're stuck somewhere, we'll be more than happy to help your questions. You can WhatsApp me. You can WhatsApp Shrey. And either one of us will be able to help you out with any questions or queries you have. Right? Sounds good? Just confirm very quickly whether you are game with this or you have any concerns. Can we all commit on doing this by Saturday afternoon? Good to go, Umesh says. Ankit is confirming, Mohit, Umesh, okay, good. Nandini already confirmed. Great, guys. So let me, so this is basically the basics of R, and we have, you know, covered, you know, some of these concepts earlier as well, so I'm not going to repeat that. So we are good to go in terms of R, and it's 8:48. Let's take a 5-minute break. So be back by 8:53. And then I'll just introduce you to some of the basic things in SAS, and then we'll be able to wrap it up by 9:45. Yeah. Vinit says, can you share your contact number? Did Shrey send the Excel file or CSV file? Shiva Kumar is asking. Yes, Shiva, Shrey would have sent yesterday. If you don't have it, I'll just ask Shrey to send you again. But he sent to everybody. Shrey, can you just check from your side whether Shiva has it or not? It is on the one learner's page, actually, Ankit is confirming. Yes, I mean, so he sent the link of the one learner's page, Shiva, and it is all uploaded there. So, I mean, I don't think he sent the physical files. He just sent out the link there. So everybody should have it on the one learner page. Okay. So, I mean, we are refraining from the practice of sending the files because that will, you know, sort of like take away the your mailbox space and, you know, heavy files and so on and so forth. So everything will be uploaded on the One Learners, but you'll get the notification when the new material is uploaded, right? So make sure that you keep on checking this page very, very often, right? You'll be seeing new material coming in there. So guys, let's take a break. Let's be back by 8:53 and then we'll quickly jump into the SAS, right? Thank you. Be back in 4 minutes, so 8:53. Okay, is everybody back? Can you just confirm? Good, good, good. So just maybe another minute or so, anybody who is running a bit behind, they can also join. So we'll be switching gears and we'll be talking about SAS. How many of you have SAS already installed and working? And who doesn't have? Ankit has it working, Umesh has it working. Okay, good. How about others? I know Siva, you are still trying to figure out something there, so in terms of the actual installation. For Vineet, it's working as well. Nandini, you have the SAS installed and working? I have it, okay. Nandini, just confirm that, okay. How about you, Dinesh? Dinesh, you already have, okay. Good. Mohit, how about you? Okay, so we'll wait for Mohit. So anyways, I mean, if you don't have it and if there is any challenge, feel free to get in touch with me or Mohit and we'll be more than happy to help you out, right? Now, I think some of you asked for the phone number to WhatsApp me, so I'm just going to add this information before I forget. So, and it should be visible to all of you. So can you just confirm whether you see my mobile number on your screen and you can make a note of that and you can feel free to add me on the WhatsApp. Okay, good. Some of you are already there on my WhatsApp, so people who are not there and they want to get in touch and they want to ask me questions or thoughts or suggestions and so on, so feel free to, right? Okay, good. So let's move on. So assume that, I mean, you have SAS for those of you who don't have. I mean, so, you know, once you have the SAS, you have to fire up the VMware. It's going to tell you, you know, what is the local machine host name. You come back in Windows. I mean, the Chrome or the browser that you're on and you type that address localhost 10080, it's going to fire up your entire SAS studio, which is what we're using for running the SAS code, right? So very, very simply, I mean, then you'll be able to move forward with everything, right? SAS is a bit more tricky than R. So I'll be talking about very, very basic concepts and this we have covered earlier as well. So proc contents basically gives you the entire content of the data. Right, so if I want to really understand, which is, you know, something similar to like the summary. So when you did the summary in R, right, so you're actually talking about the same thing in SAS. In SAS. So this is called proc contents. It's going to tell you everything about the data, right, and so on and so forth. Proc sort is basically used for sorting the data. And over here, you have to specify the name of the data that you're creating. And you have to specify the name of the variable that you're using to sort the data and so on and so forth, right? And then when we did the first lecture, we talked about different ways of summarizing the information, proc means, proc univariate, you know, and correlation and so on and so forth. So this is a repeat thing for you. I'm not going to cover that, but I will talk about some of the newer concepts. So this we'll be covering in the future lectures as we do some of the exercise like linear regression and so on and so forth. So we'll be talking about these concepts there. But this we have already covered in one of the previous lectures, so you'll have the videos to look into that, right? One more time, missing mode mean, median, one more time, missing mode median mean. Okay, sure. So, Umesh, when you basically do proc means of data, you have to specify the name of the data and missing mode median mean, they will, you're basically giving them as options. So for example, if I delete this and I will go here and I delete this, right? These are options. So, you know, SAS will give you different options, right? So the moment I hit space, it gives me basically a drop down or you can type the name directly. So for example, max I want, right? Again, hit space and it will give you another opportunity to select something else, right? So I say mean, right? And so basically you're saying when you're looking at the proc means, you know, at least generate these metrics besides the normal ones that you generate. So that is the purpose of these, Umesh. Does it help? Okay, good. Good, good, good. Perfect. So now let's talk about something else. And this is something that, again, Shrey has uploaded on the website, the Learn Learner page, and you can go from there. Right. So, and I will send a PPT as well, guys. So first thing that you do in SAS is, you know, you define your library. So, and the code for defining the library is called libname, and you define the, you first tell the name of the library, and then you define the physical location of the library. So that is how you do it, right? Now, the next thing that we most often we have to do is to actually import the file in the SAS environment, and I will talk about, you know, how you will do that. So let me highlight some of the things, and actually I take this entire code and I go and say new SAS program, and I will copy paste this entire thing because this is new information, so I'll cover very quickly for you, right? So when you say, you know, libname this, and you know what you're doing is basically you're defining a library which is named pack, right? So let me just get my marker. So you're defining a library which is called pack over here. The name of the library is, so this is the name of the library, right? This is the name, and this over here is the physical location. So this is the location of the library. Yeah, so basically it means basically where exactly on your hardware this information is sitting, right? So it could be on your C drive, it could be on your N drive, or it could be on your server. So wherever this file is located, I mean, you're just telling, you know, where exactly this file is located, right? So that's all you're doing in this. So this is how you would run a library name, and let me go ahead and run that. In, if everything goes per plan, there should be no error. So I don't see any error, so it's fine. And then this is how you actually import any file in SAS environment, right? So you say proc import out is equal to prac.sales. So you're basically saying I'm importing a file, and you know, I'm from this I'm creating a data set which is called sales, right? And you know, this is the data set that we have created. You're saying this data set is going to be located in the library called prac. And when we are creating this data file, I'm creating this data data from the data file located in this location, which is in the folders, my folders, SAS user, and the name of the files is CSV, right? So basically what you're saying here is that I'm creating a SAS data from a CSV file. That CSV file is located in this folder, and DBMS is equal to CSV tells, you know, the database format is CSV. Replace meaning if there is file already existing, you will go ahead and replace that file. Get names meaning you're also getting the header name, and then you run it. So this is how you import any file in the SAS environment. So for example, you know, you have this file sitting in this location. You want to get this file converted into a SAS data set. I will go ahead and run it. And again, no errors because the log did not generate any error, and you see the data has been already created. And you'll see that the data is existing here, because once you import this in the SAS, SAS creates a SAS data, and the extension for the SAS data is going to look like this, SAS 7B D80 and so on and so forth. So is this clear, guys, how you import a file within the SAS environment? Very quickly, yes or no? Yes, Umesh says, okay. Nandini, yes, okay. How about others? Shiva, Vineet, Ankit, Dinesh, Mohit, yeah, okay, good. So this is how very quickly you'll import a file. So I'm doing, you know, a bunch of other imports. So all of this is on the website, so you can go ahead and try that. Vineet says, can you repeat quickly? Sure, Vineet, no problem. So one of the basic features in, you know, any language is how you get the file in. So this is, you know, how we'll get it. So proc import is the procedure that we use to import a file. We are saying this file is located in this location, and the name of the file is sales.csv, which is a comma separated file, CSV file. This is the location of the file. You are importing the file and you're creating a new data which is called prac.sales, and prac is basically the name of the library. You're saying, you know, create a data set called sales, which is created over here, and the extension is basically the SAS extension over here. Right, and you're saying, you know, this data is imported, and then, you know, you're giving some pointers in terms of, you know, how this data looks like. So this is a CSV file. You're saying replace meaning, I mean, if you already have a CSV file existing in this location or SAS data existing in this location, that data is going to be replaced. Get names is nothing but, you know, getting the headers of the file from the CSV file. Right, Vineet, is it clear now or clearer? Okay, good. Good. So let's move on. So this is how you will get a file within the SAS environment, right? Now, how do I know, you know, what is there in the data? So prop contents will tell you, you know, all the things about your sort of like how many rows, how many columns you have, but it's not going to show you the actual data. So if I want to see the actual data, I have to do something which is called proc print, right? And if you look into the, you know, sort of like similarities between this and R, this is the view in R. When you click on, you know, the name of the data, or you say view, I mean, if you remember, so we say view cars, right? When you say view cars, that means basically you want to open up the table. Proc print does the same thing as it does in R. So it will say, you know, this data is residing there. I mean, I want to see this data, how this data looks like, right? So if I go and run that, it will open up the entire table. Now, let me ask you guys a question. Do you find it convenient that you're learning SAS and R both in the one go, or you would like to learn one tool at a time and then talk about the other one later? What is your personal preference? Or are you getting confused learning both tools in one go? Umesh says, I'm good. How about others? I just want to make sure that I'm not confusing you by talking about both. Dinesh says, it's fine with me. Okay. How about others? Mohit, Nandini, Shiva? It's okay. I think overall people are okay, right? So this is how you would actually get the data in. Okay, perfect. So I'm assuming... Yeah, so Umesh has really hit the nail on the head, right? So I think it's really important that you guys practice during the week. So don't make it weekend to weekend exercise. You need to take a lot of initiative yourself and start practicing these things over the weekdays, right? And feel free to reach out to me anytime if you have any question on WhatsApp. I may not necessarily be able to reply to you right away, but I promise that I'll be able to, you know, come back to you as soon as possible, right? Okay, so that's fine. So let's go ahead and run it. So Vinit says it's fine. Just elaborate more on the SAS. Sure, Vinit. So I told you about, you know, how you can print the data just like you. So right now, you know, what we're doing over here is that I'm printing a data which is called order.fact, right? And this data is resided in the library called track. And I want to also look at the sum total of the prices, right? So there's a variable called total retail price, and just like, you know, what you would do in Excel, I want to get a sum total of that column. So if I go and run it, you will see, you know, what I'm talking about. And this code is also there with you guys on the website, so you can feel free to run it whenever you get chance. So I did a sum total on the total retail price, right? So you see, if I come down to the column to the end of this data, right, so let me just quickly scan down. You see there is a sum total given here, right? So that is the benefit of, you know, sort of like looking into this. So if I want to just really look at the overall value, you can come down and you can see that, and it will be generated. So what we did is proc print data this sum of this variable. So that's where you can actually do it, right? Now let's say I don't want to print all the data. I want to print only certain data, right? Or I mean, you know, only few observations. So you can say observation is equal to 100, right? And let's say I want to, you know, not do this, so I can comment it out. So, and we know that you can comment out if you just put a star, or you can do a forward slash, star, and then again, you know, star and forward slash. They will do the same thing, right? So you can figure out, you know, what makes sense. But I'll just follow the star and comma, and that will basically make this entire thing comment. And what I'm doing here is I'm printing the first 100 observations, right? So if I go and click on it, instead of printing the entire data, I'll just look at the top 100 observations, right? So why should I print all the data? I can just look at the top 100 rows and see, you know, what is happening. So Mohit says, I don't have this file named as sales on which you are working. Mohit, this file I will share with you. So maybe it's not there One Learner space, but I'll share this file later on, right? So just bear with me, right? Or you can work with any file stored in the SAS help library for that matter. It doesn't matter, right? Okay, so this is what we did quickly, right? Now, if you have to print only the top 10 observations, I can just go and say proc print 10, and it's going to only print 10 observations, right? So it's totally my choice how many observations I want to print. Now, this is very important, and this is just giving you a primer on how you will do things in SAS. So don't worry if you don't get the entire concept, but at least you should get a very broader sense, and as we move forward, you'll get more and more visibility. So I want to print, in this case, I'm again printing the data, but I only want to print where the total retail price is greater than or equal to 500. And I want to do a summation of the retail price in the end, right? So I don't want to print all observations. I want to print only those observations where the retail price is more than 500, right? So you can do that by using the where clause in SAS statement. And if I click on it, right? So if you look at the retail price, you'll see all of these retail price over here are more than 500 because that's what we specified in the criteria, right? And it will only print those observations where the retail price is more than that, right? Now, if you go back to the results, you see there is a observation column, and basically what it does is it just gives you the row number, right? So for example, this column right here, OBS, right? The one that I'm highlighting now, it gives you the row number. So for example, I don't want to know the row number of this, right? So I can go and actually go back in the code and I can say option is no ops, right? So prop print data is equal to this, no ops, right? So exactly the same thing, but it will go ahead and suppress the observation. So if you look at the output, now the observation part is gone. There's no observation. In fact, it's replaced by the customer ID. So there's no observation. So like the row number that used to be here, that is not there. And you directly start with the customer ID. So it's very helpful in case, I mean, you don't want to necessarily know the row number of, you know, what you're looking at, right? ID is another one of those things which you can use to sort of like identify the row number. So for example, you know, I'm printing the same and I want to identify each row with the customer ID. I can go ahead and do that. And it's already there, so you'll not see, you know, anything else coming out. But if you want, you can actually ID by any variable. So for example, if I want to ID by something else, ID means unique identifier added in the beginning of the table. You can go ahead and do that, right? Any variable that you add here will become the first column in the table is basically what the sense of ID is, right? Now, if you want to, you don't have to print all the data. You can select certain data by using where command. So prop print data is equal to this. Where, meaning, you know, short for variable, and you want to only select customer ID, order ID, order type, quantity, total retail price, and so on and so forth, and you want to have these selection filters as well, you can go ahead and do that. There's, you know, so you will not get the entire data, you'll get only some of the basic things there, right? So instead of looking at the broader table, you are looking at only a selected set of variables, right? So let me pause here and see if there is any question from anyone. Is it clear? Very quickly, so these are very, very basic things in SAS along with, you know, what we discussed earlier in terms of the mean, summary, univariate that we have already covered, right? So I'm not going to spend a lot of time. So Umesh says the syntax is a little bit like SQL. That is right, Umesh. I mean, so it's very close to that. In fact, you can do, you know, a lot of SQL coding within the SAS environment by using proc SQL. And that, I mean, we can talk a little bit later. But in the interest of, you know, all the other topics that we've covered, maybe we will not spend a lot of time there, but it's a very good topic that, you know, you should know. And we'll be having some SAS specific trainings down the road. So if you want to sign up for that, I mean, you can, where you'll get more deeper into the SAS, right? So Dinesh says, looks like basic syntax will be more clear once I start practicing. Yeah, Dinesh, I agree. We'll have to practice to get a hang of the coding, Ankit says. Yeah, agree, Ankit. So let me actually just, and I don't think I have sort of like shared this. Let me just confirm if I have. So this is a PPT. I will, you know, make some changes here because I don't want to share in the current form. And then I will be circulating. So by Monday, you should have it, this PPT. And, you know, I just wanted to put together some of the basic things for you in SAS so that you are fully aware of, right? And we'll just quickly run down this PPT. So, you know, we talked about this, one of the most commonly used in analytics community, can be used for a variety of different things like data mining, reporting, statistical analysis, used by all industries. There are plenty of jobs and this is very easy to learn, right? So these are some of the motivations behind that, why we should be looking into this tool, right? you can access data from any source, manipulate, manage, analyze, summarize, you can do all of that. We'll be working with base SAS, which is, you know, what you have in the university edition. It follows basically the 80-20 rule, that 80% of the activity that you want to do will be done with base SAS. So, you know, this will be, you know, sort of like doing everything that you want to do in your real world application, right? Right now, we are actually using the SAS Studio, which is the web-based or a combination of SAS Studio and University Edition, but you can have a local installation of SAS. Some companies have, you know, local SAS installed. Other companies have the SAS EG, right, which is the Enterprise Guide, which is a server-based solution, right? But what is key is that the programming syntax and the applications are agnostic to any of these interfaces. So it doesn't matter whether you are running it on the desktop or EG or Studio or University Edition. It does not matter in terms of the programming syntax and the application, right? So that's very, very key. So whatever you learn will be applicable regardless of whether you use it in the Unix, Windows, and so on and so forth, right? And that sort of like captures that. So there are multiple operating systems, Windows, Unix, Linux, IBM mainframe, and, you know, open source, you know, operating systems where the SAS can run freely, right? Three main windows: editor window, log window, results window. As we discussed earlier, just this is just more like a recap of some of the things. Editor window is where you write the script, write your code and everything, and you will be able to run from here. Log window will tell you whether there is any error in the data, right? And you know, so on and so forth. Results window is where you will actually see that data being displayed, right? Not a new concept. I'm just reiterating these things for your benefit. You can read any files, Excel, CSV, SAS, text files, JSON, so on and so forth, right? And it will be created into a SAS dataset. SAS programs can be saved and reused for future usage. So that is fully permitted there. Consists of data step and proc step. And, you know, data step is basically primarily used for creating the SAS dataset. Procedure is for creating the report and summary and so forth. We did a quiz also there, right? Each SAS programming syntax will be ending with a semicolon, right? One of the most commonly made error. The unquoted values, basically anything which is not a character, can be uppercase, lowercase, anything that you want. We talked about the free formatting as well. That it doesn't matter, you know, which line, which column you start with, all of those things are fine, as long as you are actually typing them in the unquoted, right? So all of these are the same thing. It's a free format style. SAS comments, you know, either you use a forward slash star and, you know, star and forward slash to end the comment, or you can use a star and semicolon, right? So both of those are fine to comment. Basically, these things are not read by SAS and they'll be totally ignored, and you will be just looking into the remaining portion, right? SAS syntax error, I mean, a lot of times it will be automatically detected. So for example, if I misspelled the D-A-A-T-A, so it should be data, right? So let's say for whatever example, you know, I was not able to remember, or, you know, I did a mistake. So instead of typing data, I typed this. SAS will in most cases figure out that there's a typo and it will fix it and then run with that, right? So it's smart enough from that point of view. Syntax errors, so for example, you know, when I made the typo, it was say that assuming that symbol data was misspelled as data, it fixed and ran with that, right? Now, what is the syntax error here, guys? Can anybody point out what is the syntax error here? Any comments? Single quote, Umesh says, right? So if you remember, I mean, we said, I mean, you cannot mix the single quote and double quote. Either you use your single quote or you use your double quote. You cannot mix both of them, right? And the other syntax error is data is misspelled. So this will be fine. SAS will be able to run with this. It will be basically notified as warning, right? But this will be error. This line will not be executed. So your entire SAS program will not work, because now SAS is confused, you know, what really you want to do, right? Yeah, okay, perfect. SAS libraries, we talked about, you know, there are permanent libraries which will be, you know, allocated. So for example, PRAC that we created is a permanent library. There will be temporary libraries which are called work, right? So if I name any file with work.xyz, that means XYZ is a temporary file, and the moment I close my SAS session, it will be totally gone. So there is no file called XYZ the moment I close the SAS session. So anything that is stored in the work is a temporary file, right? And any file which is not stored there will be a permanent file, and they will always follow the name nomenclature, where you have to say library name, lib name, right? Library name, and then you have dot, and then you have the data name, right? So that is how we actually use it. Clear? Any questions so far, guys? This is some of the repeat information, but I just want to make sure that before we deep dive into the actual workings, I mean, everybody is comfortable with this. Any questions? Yeah? No? Okay, perfect. No questions? Okay. So proc contents we talked about, this is something that you should actually just sort of try to memorize, that numerical variables are stored using 8 bytes, character variables are stored using 1 to 30, 32, 7, 6 bytes. Each byte will store one character, right? Each numerical value can be stored using 8 bytes. If 8 bytes are not significant, it's going to be converted into the E notation or the scientific notation, right? So basically, any number can be stored using the 8 bytes, but the character variables, each character variable will require 1 byte, right? SAS names can be 1 to 32 characters long. They will always start with the letter and underscore. Rest of the characters can be numbers, letters, underscore. So for example, it cannot start with dollar. It cannot start with underscore, right? So none of these are permitted. So they will always be starting with either a letter or an underscore, right? So sorry, I mean, underscore is permitted, so but dollar is not permitted, or number two is not possible. So you'll have to start with underscore or letter, right? And they can be in uppercase or lowercase, that doesn't matter. We talked about, you know, how you select the variables, everything, right? We talked about the filtering as well. So for example, you can say, if I want to select only those cars where the miles per gallon is more than 15, I can select those. I only want to select two variables, which are model and MPG, so that can be easily done as well, right? ID statement we talked about, sorting we talked about, titles and footnotes. Basically, anytime you are working on that, you can add a title on the page, and the command for that is very, very simple, like shown here, right? So you can wait. I think I removed that. So, but it's there in the SAS code. You can actually say, for example, if I want to print a title on my everything, so I can say title 1, and then I can, you know, have the name. So my homework, right? And then close that and have a semicolon. So basically on all page, this title is going to be printed. And then you, when you want to cancel that, you just basically in the end say title 1 and semicolon, it will be removed, right? So that you'll see in some future learnings. I mean, so don't worry, right? So here, do you create a library prac, or do you have prac library in your SAS? Ankit is saying, no, Ankit, I'm creating a library called prac, right? So this is a permanent library, but I have created this in a previous step, right? So I'm not creating here. I'm just saying, you know, data is residing in this location. My data is residing in a library called prac, and the name of the data is cars. So I'm not creating, I'm just telling SAS, where is my data? So I'm saying, you know, sort the data which is residing in the library called prac. The name of the data is cars, and you have to sort by origin in the descending order, and miles per gallon and horsepower. So you can sort by multiple variables. And then you're saying, store this data in a temporary file called work.cars. Yeah? Okay. SAS dates, very quickly guys, this you'll see sometimes being used. So SAS, what it does is basically it uses the point of reference, and the point of reference is 1st January 1960. So if I'm looking at, you know, a date which is 1st January 1960, SAS will store it as a zero, and all the dates will be in reference to that. So for example, 1st January 1961 will be stored as 366, because that's 366 days from the 1st January 1960. If I'm going back, it will be minus value, right? So for example, 2016 some date in 2016 will be again in reference to that, so that would be, you know, that many days that SAS will be storing. But once you have stored that, you can actually format that in different ways. So you can say month, month, date, year, 6, basically it will be stored as this way. You know, similarly, you can, you know, follow different formats, and basically this you can specify in the SAS formatting, where you say over here, for example, so format higher date is month, month, day, day, year 10, which is going to be stored as this way, right? Similarly, salary, which is a numerical number, you're saying, you know, that is going to be used with the dollar terminology. You're going to have 8 significant digits before the decimal, and after decimal, you're not going to have any digits, right? So some of these things you can, you know, experience a bit more later on. But that's just a very, very brief about the SAS, and you'll see some of these things when we get into the actual modeling exercise. So any question from anyone, guys? Or is it at least the basics are clear? Yeah? Okay, perfect. So those were the topics that we had for today. So unless you guys have anything, we will close out the session for today. But with the commitment from you that you will give it the try in terms of the assignment through the week, and don't postpone it till the end, and you will try to finish it and ask any questions and work on it actively and come back by Saturday with your output. Does it sound okay, guys? Okay, perfect. So if no further question, then we'll close out the session today, and we'll meet again in next Saturday's discussion. Tomorrow, Amit will be talking about the Tableau, right? So Umesh is saying, RP is the homework in R or SAS? The homework is just in R, Umesh, not in SAS at this time, just in R. Ankit has a question. Yeah, go ahead, Ankit. So Ankit says, does this command libname prac create library? That is exactly right, Ankit. It's not creating a library. The physical location is already there, but you're just telling that I want to call this physical location as prac, and this library is existing in this folder. Is that clear, Ankit? Vinit says, can you please send the presentation? Definitely, Vinit. We'll upload this presentation on the OneLearners page and give you guys a notification. So Dinesh says, can we expect the homework in R, the PPT and other documents from Shrey via email tonight or tomorrow? Dinesh, all the things are uploaded on the OneLearners except the SAS PPT, but the homework is already there. The CSV file required for the homework is already there, and you are good to go in terms of trying it out. So tomorrow you can give it a try, or during the weekdays, I mean, whenever you have time, you are good to go for trying the homework in R, right? All the files are there. Okay, any other questions from anyone, since we have a few minutes remaining? Mohit, anything from your side? Nandini? No more questions? Okay, perfect. So I'll give you guys some time today, and we'll meet again on Saturday. Tomorrow, Amit will be talking about Tableau, and like I said, do try the homework. I'll be expecting, you know, some responses from you. In case if you're stuck somewhere, I'll be more than happy to help you out there, right? Okay, perfect. Thank you, guys. Talk to you soon. Have a good night. Bye-bye. So Ankit says, do we have to submit the R script or Word file? Just Word file will do, Ankit. Okay. Thanks. Thanks, everyone. I'm closing out. Thank you. Have a good night. Bye.